Faye, if you don't mind then just giving us your name and your surname for the record, please.
Suzanne Walker Daniels.
And your former position?
Head of Legal and Compliance at Eskom and Group Company Secretary.
Tell me, why have you decided now to come forward and speak about this? And what is it that you actually want to say?
Well, now is appropriate because I'm not tied to the chains of confidentiality at being at Eskom. I've also been spurred on by encouraged by other reports of whistleblowers, watching the State Capture Commission, or not watching it, but reading about the State Capture Commission witnesses and their testimony. It's similar to the experience that I have had. So I feel there's a greater need to speak out about the fact that there are all these high-profile whistleblowers in the country who are saying more or less the same story, different context, different time, and in really powerful positions, for want of a better word. You know, it's not in the normal public perceptions, those are really powerful positions. And yet being treated the way that we have.
So do you believe that you were pushed out?
I don't think there was an agenda to get me back into Eskom. I think the from the disciplinary inquiry it was pretty clear. You know, the thing is for me not to come back. And we put up the best defense that we could, and actually put all the, actually had more documents than Eskom had, because I obviously had the institutional knowledge of what had happened. But that was disregarded in respect of the findings. So I think, yeah, push out is probably a good word to describe what happened.
In your opinion, are there still people within Eskom who had benefited through some of these dodgy deals?
I think so. I think when we started investigating more, it became very clear that there was a system. There was like a parallel universe that one needed to uncover. And I think it would take quite a while to clean it up.
Even though we have a new board, a new minister, a new CEO, do you think that it's changed the rot within Eskom?
I don't think it's changed. I mean, they're beginning to deal with it, but it's going to take a long time. It's going to take a long time. You must remember, Eskom has been around for longer than you and I have been alive. And the systems are pretty deep, and there are people who've been within that system for all of their lives. So, you know, they would know how to deal with things.
So we've heard your testimony to Parliament, and you explained your meeting with RJ Gupta and a number of others where you generally felt uncomfortable. So my question is twofold. Did you in any way benefit through some of the deals that Eskom made in terms of making these millions? And secondly, what was your relationship like with the Guptas or the Gupta associates in this time before, during and after you compiled this report of what Eskom had done?
On the first question, no, I did not benefit from these deals. Eskom tried to portray my promotion to company secretary as how I benefited. But I mean, I've been in Eskom I was at Eskom for almost 10 years before that happened. So that, you know, that argument doesn't hold water. On the second issue, as I testified, I met Salim Essa. I had no relationship with the Guptas until that day, that meeting in Melrose Arch, where I met Mr. Ajay Gupta. And that was just the biggest, you know, like the cherry on top of everything. I'd already made the decision to disclose what I knew, just waiting for the the parliamentary inquiry. But then that was just like the cherry on top of the cake. I thought, you know, that's it. When I spoke in Parliament about, I know that state capture is real, I meant it, because here I was, and I saw a high-ranking government official, the president's son and the Gupta brother in one room, and absolute deference been given to someone who ought not to have been in that position. You know, I mean, he had no business knowing so much about the inner workings of government, inner workings of the judiciary and things like that. So it was like listening to, it was actually like listening to the president. And that's when I felt that we just don't own this country. So I think my relationship was that short-lived meeting, and it just left me with a sense of disgust and horror at what we'd allowed to happen in the country.
Is there someone or something that could still emerge that might put someone or something or some company or in the spotlight following your dismissal, you said?
Yes, there are a few things that I haven't said because they weren't in the context for the hearing. I suppose if the State Capture Commission were to ask me very pertinent questions like I see they are doing, there will be some more information that would come out.
So, Suzanne, for South Africans now, you are no longer with Eskom. You have been through a lot in the past few months, in the past year, in fact. What is it that you want South Africans to know now that you are no longer an employee of Eskom? You are going to pursue the matter further. You feel that, you know, the way that you were treated in general wasn't fair. But what is it that you want South Africans to know?
I would encourage South Africans to, if they do have information about corruption, to actually still come forward. You know, the bad times don't last forever. And I think it requires citizens to be more aware. We can't leave it up to the government of the day to decide for us. I think we need to be more aware and more vigilant in our own daily practices and see, you know, root out. Because corruption seems to be endemic, not only in the public sector, this is just a South African phenomenon right now. And I would strongly urge people to be a bit more vigilant and not as accepting as we are.
Do you have any regrets at your time at Eskom?
No, I don't actually. I did what was right. I did what was needed. And unfortunately, some people don't think so. And I will deal with that in the appropriate forum.